Okay, so, well, sharing a screen, a video is not the best idea in the world. We got that. So welcome, everybody, to our first online edition of Astronomy on Tap. So first, to begin with, I'd like to present the sponsors. So why is this slide not working? Oh, yeah. Okay, perfect. So I would like to thank our sponsor who help us organize these events and help us continue to organize these talks. So I'd like to thank the Swiss Space Center from EPFL, the eSpace, the LSTRO, the European Space Talks, the European Observatory, and from EPFL, as well as the Astronomy on Tap Lausanne team. And obviously, something is wrong with the... You guys can hear me? And obviously you guys. So thank you for coming all. As we can see, we're around 35 participants, which is not bad actually for an online edition, an online meeting. So for today, we're gonna, well, we were not gonna do an Astronomy on Tap. That's gonna be the usual thing. So first of all, I'd like to talk to you about our association, which is based at your service. So what we do is organizing stuff that is space related. So organizing conferences, doing promotion of space, organizing the Astronomy on Taps. And also we have a few big interdisciplinary project that we're handling at EPFL, which is the Asclepios project. So I think some of you guys must have heard about it. So for today, we're going to talk about something quite special, which is CHEOPS, which is actually a Swiss satellite that has been sent to space not long ago, actually. And the one who will present CHEOPS is Dr.Andrea Fortier. She actually worked on CHEOPS, so she started working on it when it was nothing, like just ideas, until the launch, and she even went to see the launch. So I'd like you guys to virtually applaud her, and I'm gonna give her the speech. So we can stop sharing this, and I'll give the thing to Andrea.
Thank you, Kevin. I will start sharing my presentation. Can you hear me okay? I guess that's a yes. So thanks a lot to the organizers for inviting me to this experiment of doing a talk online. Thanks to all of you for being participating and for having interest in something else that was happening to all of us right now, and to be motivated to hear about astronomy, exoplanets, and CHEOPS in particular. So what I want to tell you is what CHEOPS is and how it became a reality since the first idea that was in 2007. So I work at the University of Bern. I'm the instrument scientist, and let's start. I will not say that you can interrupt me at any time, because it will be a bit a problem, but I will welcome questions when I finish. So let's start from the very beginning, before even CHEOPS could be in the mind of anybody. So you, especially the Swiss people and the interested in astronomy, may have heard about the first exoplanet that was discovered in 1995. By two Swiss astronomers, Michel Mayor and Didier Queloz from the University of Geneva, that last year won the Nobel Prize for this discovery. What was amazing and why this received the Nobel Prize is because it revolutionized the astronomy field, pointing towards something that was known. It was probably known that exoplanets exist, but it was confirmed. And the most amazing thing is that it was nothing what we expected. The first exoplanet is 51 Pegasi b, and it was completely different from what we know from the solar system. It's a planet that is the size of Jupiter, has half of its mass, and it goes around its star, that is a solar-like star, in 4 days. And to put this into perspective and to see how everything evolved in the last 25, 30 years, let's see what was our knowledge until the discovery of the first exoplanet. So we knew only 5 planets, only the planets of the solar system, but then Pluto was still considered a planet. This is another topic of discussion. A new definition of planets came after 2000, and Pluto was kicked out of the league. We knew only one, and we still know only one, that hosts life, that is the Earth. And to have an idea of the dimensions and numbers, the closest planet that we knew was Mercury, that is actually the smallest planet of the solar system, that revolves about the sun in 88 days. And the planet that was farther away was Pluto, that completes an orbit in 249 years. And if we want to characterize them and to put them into categories, we would say that we have 3 categories, the rocky planets that are the inner planets, the gaseous planets that are Jupiter and Saturn that are very massive and basically composed by hydrogen and helium, and the icy planets like Uranus and Neptune. So what happened since then? Well, our knowledge has broadened a lot. We have around 4,250 exoplanets confirmed, of which around 3,100 are part of planetary systems. So there are more than one planet around a star. And although we cannot confirm yet, or we don't know if there is life, we know that there are around 15 exoplanets that are in the habitable zone of their stars, which means that liquid water can be on their surface. They are probably of rocky composition and let's say alike the Earth. Then numbers go also crazy when we see the closest planet is revolving around the star in 4.3 hours. So in less time than it takes to go across Switzerland, this planet is going around its star. And the one that is farther away, it takes 1 million years to do a revolution. And now that we have seen this variety of the SWU exoplanet field, there are also new planets that are not present in the solar system that can be characterized, like super-Earths, so Earth-like analogs that are bigger, or mini-Neptunes that are Neptune-like planets that are smaller, ocean planets that are composed all in its surface, let's say, by liquid water or ocean, lava planets, because these are rocky planets that are so close to their stars that their surface is melted, hot Jupiters like the first exoplanet known, hot Neptunes because it's Neptune-like planet that is very close to their star, etc. So there is a lot of new things and a lot of things to be explained by this new field that started with the discovery of the first exoplanet. But then the question is, how are exoplanets found? Because it's not like stars, like let's say we look at the sky and we see the stars. In general, we cannot see planets, exoplanets directly. We cannot take pictures of them. We know them by what they cause on their star. So we know them through indirect detections. And there are two main indirect detections that allow the majority of discoveries. And the first one that was used for the first discovery is what's called the radial velocity technique. Basically, all the radial velocity discovered planets are done from Earth observatories, so observatories that are on the ground. The idea is that once surveys the sky, so we look at certain regions of the sky and we just keep looking, and see if we find variations in what we measure of the stars. And what variations are we looking here at? Well, if there is a planet going around a star and we take the spectra of the star, because of the gravity that the planets exert to the star, they are both moving around their common center of mass. And the lines that are present in the spectrum will move as the pull of the planet affects the stars. So we will have the lines moving from the red part of the spectrum to the blue part of the spectrum, depending on the position of the planet. And what kind of planets can we find? Because we are talking about variations that are very small. If we were to look at Jupiter producing this movement of the lines on the sun, we will measure that the velocity of the sun is around 13 meters per second. That is the precision we are talking about. And if we want to measure the pull of the Earth, we will talking about being able to measure something that moves at 9 centimeters per second. So with this technique, we are biased, or we are favoring the discovery of very massive planets that can exert a strong force, and the planets that are close to their host stars, because distance is also favoring the moving of the star. And this depends only on the masses involved. So bigger planets, more massive planets, will have a greater effect. So we will discover essentially more massive planets or closer planets around very bright stars. The second method for detection, for indirect detection, it's maybe easier to explain, is what's called transit photometry. And it's a geometrical effect. So if we are observing at a star, and there is a planet that is revolving around the star and it's crossing the stellar disk while we are observing, we will see that the planet is blocking part of the light that is coming from the star. And therefore, when the planet is not blocking the star, we will receive, let's say, a constant amount of light. But when the planet is crossing by, we will see that the amount of light decreases. The number of photons that we are able to measure will decrease because the planet is blocking part of the surface of the star. How much that this light decreases, how much is the depth of what we call this transit depth, the drop in the brightness of the star, will depend on the size of the planet. Smaller planets will not impact very much and will not block a lot of light. But bigger planets will block much more of the surface of a star. So we will see a variation that is bigger. And it will depend also where it crosses the stellar surface, that we will see different shapes on this light curve, on how deep it goes and how narrow it is. But then we can think it in another way also and say, if we have a planet always of the same size, but we put it in front of different stars, if the star is small, we will see a greater signal than if the star is big. So what are the best targets? Well, large planets compared to the surface of the star. And again, we are talking about measuring things that vary very little. So the transit of Jupiter, if we were to measure it outside from the solar system, will cause a variation in the light curve of 1%. But the transit of an Earth will cause a variation of 0.01% in the amount of light that we receive from the sun. So again, this method also favors certain discoveries, that is big planets, because they block more on the stellar surface, and close in, and this is a question of probability, that close in planets have a higher probability of being in transit than the ones that are distant. The main message here is that with this technique, we are able to know the size of the planet. So what is the radius? So basically with these two indirect techniques, if we can measure, do the two measurements on one star that has a planet, what we know is what the planet mass is due to the Doppler shift, so how much it affects the movement of the star, and what the size of the planet is. So is it big or is it small? And when we have these two quantities, we have the first thing to characterize the composition of a planet, that is the mean density. So you know the mass divided by the volume of an object gives us the mean density. Now, why this is so important? Well, because if we do models where we put mass, a certain mass of a certain composition, we can see what the size of that object of that planet will be. And therefore, if we do a lot of these trials of different masses, different compositions, we have the radius. And so then if I come and I measure the mass and the radius, I can have a very good idea of what a planet is made of. So there is a limiting value for having planets that are 100% made of iron. We cannot have something more compact. And then there is a limiting value also for having planets that are made of a solid composition up to water and then gaseous planets. And the thing is that as the mean density goes with the mass, but also with the volume, and here is where the radius of the planet enters at the exponent 3, an uncertainty in the radius determination is what dominates the uncertainty in the estimated mean density. This means that we can usually measure very precisely the masses, but a little uncertainty in the radius propagates as a very big uncertainty in the mean density. And with this background that we have now, I can imagine a kind of a discussion that was held in 2007 when the people started to think about CHEOPS. I can imagine, so sorry, what did you just say? And yes, the uncertainty in the radius determination dominates the uncertainty in the estimated density. Then if we measure the exoplanet's radius accurately enough for the cases where we know their masses from the radial velocity measurements, so from the Doppler effect, we can reduce the uncertainty on their mean density, because as I said, masses are usually very well defined, very well determined, but it's the radius where we have to improve our knowledge. Yes, that's right. If we know this, if we know the radius with good precision, we will know the composition of exoplanets. So what we need is a space observatory, because when we do photometry, we are very much affected by the atmosphere. So we need to go to space to get the best measurements. And we need an observatory because we want to observe planets that are already known. I want to point in the sky anywhere I want because I know that there is a planet. And what I want to do is to measure it as good as possible. So the idea was to have a telescope devoted to measure radius of extrasolar planets and trying to point anywhere where there is a candidate, a target that we want to observe. So CHEOPS right now can observe 70% of the sky. The ecliptic poles are excluded for technical reasons that I can explain if you're interested. But almost most of the sky is accessible for pointing. And what is what we want to measure? Because we are trying to find analogs to the Earth. We want to be able to measure, to detect and to characterize Earth-like planets. And I said before that a transiting Earth only causes a variation in the light curve of 0.01%. And to be sure that we are measuring that and that we have enough precision, we have to measure this better than a 20% precision. So we need to be able to detect a variation in the light curve of 100 parts per million with a precision better than 20 parts per million. So how did all happen? Well, as I said, the idea started in 2007, even before I came to Switzerland and I even heard about this project, but I came here in 2010 and from now and then I heard in a conversation this idea that was moving back and forth until in 2012, the European Space Agency launched a call for the first small mission. Small mission means that it has to be done fast and within a small budget, so a cheap mission. And so CHEOPS was one of the 50 participants in this, and it was selected in a very fast track. We proposed in June, and the selection was in October. And there is where we started to design the instrument. And the complete design was finished by 2015. CHEOPS is a 30 centimeter telescope that has only one instrument, that is a CCD that does photometry. And the aim is that it should be extremely stable. The instrument is placed on a platform, on a satellite that is provided by Airbus. And in this platform, the purpose of the platform is to provide the energy for the operation of the instrument, to provide the pointing, because we want to point anywhere or almost anywhere in the sky, to keep the cooling of the instrument, and to do all the onboard computations needed. So from 2015 till 2017, all the pieces of the telescope were produced by the different partners that formed the CHEOPS Consortium, and all the pieces were sent to the University of Bern, where there is a dedicated vacuum chamber to do the assembly of the telescope. And this was finished by the end of 2017. And after that, a calibration of the instrument took place in Bern. And then during 2018 and 19, the instrument was integrated with the spacecraft and did sort of an European tour to different measurement facilities and test facilities, where different tests, acoustic tests, vibration tests were made to ensure that everything was working without any problem, without interference, and that it was able to survive the launch. So in 2019, CHEOPS was ready and we were waiting for the launch. In September, it was sent to the French Guiana in Kourou. And I'm going to show you a video that ESA made, so you can see how was the preparation for the launch and the launch itself. So here it's French Guiana, and you can see the satellite being prepared to go into the head of the rocket. You can see the golden cover that is to protect the telescope so it doesn't get any dust or any dirt during the launch and during all the preparations. And that's the head of the rocket where CHEOPS and all the satellites were flown. We were the secondary passengers. The first passenger is an Italian satellite, and there were three CubeSats. You can only see CHEOPS because for security reasons, there are no recordings of the other satellites when being prepared. Everybody that was there, that were engineers from ESA, took pictures and signed the rocket. And there you see the rocket going to the launch pad. It arrives to the launch pad and it's placed. And there is the head with all the satellites coming in to be integrated with the rocket. that's the day of the launch. It was raining and you see the engines were already burning and it's about to lift off. And it lift off and it was beautiful, very moving. A lot of power. Okay, so that was the launch of CHEOPS. It was very exciting to be there. The first launch attempt was on the 17th and it was canceled due to a problem 1 hour and 30 minutes before the launch. But on the 18th, everything went perfect and CHEOPS was injected in its orbit as by the books. It was absolutely perfect, everything that happened during that launch. And where is CHEOPS now? Well, CHEOPS is orbiting around the Earth at 700 kilometers from the surface of the Earth with a longitude of the ascending node of 6 a.m. So it means that it always flies over our heads at 6 a.m. and 6 p.m. local time. And it's going around the Earth over the day-night terminator. This is to minimize the stray light, the reflected light from the Earth on the images. And it gives it back to the sun. So also it's powered in the solar panels, charging batteries. And then every time it flies over Madrid, where the antenna is, it communicates to the ground. And it receives the telecommands that says where it has to point and what kind of pictures it has to take. And it also sends down the data acquired. So in times of conspiracy theories, I think it's good to prove that CHEOPS is actually in the sky, it's really in the sky. And it was observed by Earth telescopes. So here you can see this light. This is a picture taken from Mexico from the Scientex telescope, and this line here is the trajectory of CHEOPS. We have something similar taken from the observatory of Geneva, the University of Geneva. So CHEOPS is going here. And then also a colleague from Stockholm made a video. It's a bit faint, but I don't know if you see here this point moving close to the arrow. Well, that's CHEOPS. So one can, with a telescope, point to the sky and we'll find CHEOPS when it's meant to be there. So it's true. The images are not fake. So, okay. What happened next? So on the 8th of January, we started what's called the in-orbit commissioning of CHEOPS. That is, we start the communication with the satellite and we start preparing the instrument and fine-tune it to start the science observations later on. The commissioning lasted for 3 months. We have on the 19th of January, the cover opening. So this cover that I told you that was there to protect it from the dust opened perfectly well. It was a very stressful moment because you can imagine that if the cover doesn't open, we cannot observe anything. So you have a very happy team there celebrating that everything went perfect. And shortly after we received the first light, so the first image of a star taken by CHEOPS. So what you see here, this sort of triangular, semicircular thing is a star, the same as all that are here. And this is because the telescope defocuses the images. It has a size of around 16 pixels in radius. And the triangular shape, if somebody's interested, I can explain later, it has to do with a deformation that was expected of the mirror when the temperature changes from the lab temperature at 20 degrees to the space temperature at minus 10 degrees. So things were just as expected. And we've been working very hard in this 2 months and a half. And last week, on the 25th of March, all doing home office, but everything on time. The board that evaluates CHEOPS said that CHEOPS passed successfully the commissioning and that was ready to start nominal operations. And this means that the science will start after Easter. We are doing the last checks and the last tunings, and we will start producing science very soon. So, so to summarize and reaching an end, CHEOPS is a reflector telescope of 30 centimeters aperture, which purpose is to do high accuracy transit photometry. And here, what we select is quality over quantity, meaning that we are not observing 100,000 of stars like survey telescopes, like for instance, Kepler, TESS, or COROT, but we work with relatively small samples, but of well-selected stars with a very good scientific background to be observed. In the lifetime of CHEOPS, that is supposed to be around 3 years and a half, we will observe between 600 and 1,000 stars. And it's a single target pointing. So we select individual stars, stars that have a history, not randomly chosen. And for that, we need a lot of sky availability, and CHEOPS is actually capable to access 70% of the sky in one full year of observation. So the important thing also for Switzerland is that CHEOPS is a jointly led Swiss and ESA mission. So ESA covers around 50% of the total budget, but then the leading role of the mission is in Switzerland. The management and the whole responsibilities on the consortium led by Switzerland, of which also 10 other European countries participate. And the leading house is the University of Bern, in very close collaboration, of course, with the University of Geneva, where all the scientific data is received and processed. For you to have an idea, I told you that CHEOPS is a small mission with a small budget. This is for space around 110 million in the case of CHEOPS, and compared to other space missions, it's really, really low cost. And finally, I want to show you how CHEOPS images look like. I cannot show you yet a transit-like curve because there are proprietary issues. There will be a press release in 2 weeks where you will be able to see an incredible light curve of a transit that we have obtained. But in the meantime, let me show you what are the kinds of images that we receive when we first open the data of CHEOPS. So here you will see one orbit of the satellite repeating over and over again. So the target star is in the center, and you see other stars here that with the same shape that are fainter stars in this case that are going around, and this is because CHEOPS is rotating while it's revolving around the Earth. This is completely normal and expected. You see that there is here like a shower of bright pixels. These are cosmic rays. There is a region around the Earth that is called the South Atlantic Anomaly, where the magnetic field of the Earth has a weaker point, and there are much more charged particles that when they go through the CCD, through the camera, they interact with the CCD and produce this. They appear and disappear. And this happens for some orbits for times that can be between 5 minutes and 20 minutes. The other things that you see appearing and disappear are also cosmic rays. And the little bright things that you see here, these are not stars. The stars all look like this. These little dots are what are called hot pixels. These are pixels that have, let's say, a self-luminous behavior, or what's called, they have a higher dark current. Yes, this happens with time. There are more and more because the CCD ages. I don't want to go into all the technicalities, but we can discuss that later. So this star that I'm showing here, as I say in the title, is a bright orange star. And the idea is we wanted to have a bright star that had nothing special because we are testing the instrument. So if we know in advance that the star doesn't change, any change that we can see should be due to the instrument. And we had an instrument performance that was exquisite, that is exquisite. And we know that our requirement of being able to measure 20 ppm for 20 parts per million for a transit that is 100 parts per million is more than satisfied. So stay tuned. There will be news very soon. And thank you for listening. And I hope you learn a bit about CHEOPS. Thanks.
Thank you very much, Andrea, for this conference. So now we're going to pass on to the questions. So how does it work? If you didn't read the chat, so you have the option to raise your hand in Zoom. And once someone raises his hand, the admin will unmute you and you'll be able to talk, okay? So is it all good for everyone? Did you guys understand the instructions for the questions? Did you hear me? Or I think it's all good. Okay, are there any questions or? I know usually we offer stickers for people who ask questions, but right now it's kind of difficult to give these stickers. But if you still ask a question, we'll send you an online version of the sticker if you want. We'll send you the PDF. So no questions?
People are shyer when they are.
Virtually. People are shyer on Zoom. Don't worry, we won't show your face, just the mic, so you can just talk. We don't even have to
be completely anonymous.
I have a question.
Yes.
It's kind of a not question, but in one of the videos that you sent, you can see the people who prepare the satellite before launch, and they're all dressed in yellow. And I was wondering why this color.
I have no clue. I have no idea. I mean, we were not even participating in this part. So I have only seen the video as you. I have no clue why yellow.
And what is it like to see like your mission that you've been designing for 5 years launch on a rocket? I mean, that must be a wonderful feeling, right?
It's amazing. It's something that... I can tell you, well, how was it for me, the different steps. You work so hard and it's so wonderful to see something that it was from papers, really, from the proposal was 33 pages. And then you see the satellite going in a rocket to the space. And the first day when it was aborted, the launch, that you don't know because nobody tells you why, you feel like, okay, and what happens next? And then the next day, everything goes well. And during the launch, I was still not really totally convinced of what was happening. Then 2 hours later, we knew that it was injected into the orbit, and then you start to feel it's more real. And 20 minutes later, we received the first communication with the satellite, the first telemetry saying like, I'm alive. And there it was like everything became true and you say, okay, we are there. And then during this period of 3 months during the commissioning, waiting for the cover to open, seeing the first light. I don't know, it's difficult to explain. It's so wonderful to be part of something like this. Also to work with a lot of people. I mean, we are a great team and it's a collaboration that is so international and you have colleagues from everywhere in Europe. and everybody with one objective, that is to make it work. And yeah, it's amazing.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you. So we have a question from Mart that wasn't able to ask the question. So it's to explain how pointing of CHEOPS works. Sorry.
Yes. So it has reaction wheels to point wherever you command it to point. So this is all in the platform. So basically, you tell the satellite where you want to point, where is the location of the star or the point in the sky, and the telescope turns into that direction. The pointing precision is incredible. It's usually less than 1 or 2 pixels. That means 1 or 2 arc seconds, that is the scale we have. And for such a light instrument that only weighs 260 kilos, it's an extremely good pointing. We were expecting, let's say, something that was worse. It basically stays in the same pixel during an observation. So the pointing is great. It reacts very well. And basically, well, I don't know what else to say. It's helped by the, of course, the star trackers that say how to point. I don't know if there is a more specific question about the pointing. This is the general thing.
Okay, so we have a question from Cecilia. So Cecilia, would you like to talk, or you want me to directly ask the question? See, no answer. Okay. Well, I'll just ask it for her then. Cecilia is asking, are already the stars listed for the observation, or you can add new ones during the mission?
The two things. So we have a list of targets. So it works like this. 80% of the time of CHEOPS goes to the members of the consortium that has built the instrument, and 20% of the time is open to anybody that wants to apply and is held by ESA. The list of targets to be observed in the next 3.5 years are known. We have them, but this doesn't mean that they cannot be changed. Anybody can request, so the guest observers, that is what is handled by ESA, every year there is a call, and so the targets for 1 year are known. From the consortium side, we know the targets for the full 3.5 years, but we can change them if we find that there is a target that appears that is more interesting than one we have, and so we can replace it. So in a way, we know the targets, but it's very flexible. We can change them.
Okay, so Maria Paula has a question, so we'll unmute you now so that you can ask it. So let's see if you're unmuted. Okay, so you can talk. Hi. Maria.
Hi, everyone. Hi, Andre.
Hola.
Hola. Okay, I would like to know, you said something about those hot pixels.
Mm-hmm.
So are they broken? I didn't understand that.
Yeah, so we go into the technicalities of the CCD. So the CCD has something that we call dark current, that are electrons that are excited because they are at a certain temperature. These the colder you are, the less that it affects. So actually, the mean dark current of our CCD is basically almost not measurable. It's very low. However, due to interaction with the charged particles, the individual pixels can be excited and produce much more dark current than the nominal one. And this is what is happening to these pixels that we call hot pixels. So in a way, they are damaged by a hit of a charged particle that made them have more production of these electrons, of this dark current, and so they have their own emission in a way. The thing with these hot pixels is that you can have them in two kinds. If they are stable, if they are constant, and you know how much light they produce, there is no problem because it's a constant contribution, and for the kind of measurements that we want to do, this doesn't affect our measurements. The problem is if they change, and what we are seeing is that they are very variable, so they change from different states in an unpredictable way, and therefore you have to, and this is what we are studying, how to treat them properly so that they don't affect so much our measurements. But basically what we notice with many of them is that the amount of energy that they produce changes with time, and there is nothing that predicts how it changes.
Okay, thank you, Andre.
Okay, thank you very much for the question. Is there anyone that has questions, or is it all good for everyone? Don't be shy, huh? You can ask whatever question you want. You have someone who actually worked on it, so you don't get to have this chance every day. It's not someone that just made a few Google searches on internet, so ask whatever question you have. No one? Maybe. Well, I think it's all good for the questions. Let me see. Okay. Well, I'd like to thank you, Andrea, for your participation. Oh, I think there's a question here. Oh, yeah, there's a question actually. Okay, you can ask your question. Wait. Cecilia is asking, after the 3-year mission of CHEOPS, what will it happen? What will happen to the satellite?
Yeah. So we have first the nominal lifetime is 3.5 years. If everything goes well, we will ask for an extension of 1.5 year more. And all this is basically covered. And after that, whenever CHEOPS stops working, there is not a real law, but some countries or some space agencies apply this law that you are obliged to decommission the satellite. So the satellite is prepared to deorbit whenever it stops working, and there will be no space debris from CHEOPS or not the shunk in orbit after the instrument finishes its work. So it has fuel, propellant, and everything needed for the decommission.
Okay, thank you. We have one more question from Clément. Clément, you can ask your question. You're unmuted.
Yeah. Hi, everyone. My question is, how many targets do you plan to observe each day, or which frequency?
So it's difficult to say because depending on the kind of study that you want to do, you can be observing the same target for 1 week, for example, if you're interested in doing something that is called phase curves. Or you can observe one target for 20 minutes or 100 minutes, depending on the scientific purpose of the observation. On average, I would say that one expects maybe to have observations that are 1 or 2 days long. But it really, really depends on the purpose of the observation. So the idea is not so much how long you are observing, but that you are fulfilling all the observation time so that the telescope is not idle doing nothing. And all this is optimized with with an algorithm that is the one that does the planning when you know the targets. And the planning is done every week. So every week we upload all the targets that are going to be observed during 1 week, when the pointing has to be done, how much time you have to stare at a certain star. And we minimize the time that the telescope is doing nothing. Basically, that is something that should almost never happen.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, we have a question from Grégoire, so he's unmuted. You can talk, Grégoire.
Hello, everybody. Thank you for this good presentation. You said that it was quite a cheap mission, and I was wondering what would you have added to the satellite with a bigger budget?
Okay. Probably there are several things. The thing that, the as you have seen, we have the field stars rotating around the target star. This was done for thermal reasons, and maybe if we would have to have more time and money to study how to keep everything stable without that, that would have been great, because the fact that the stars are rotating is a major thing for the treatment of the images and the science we want to extract. It's giving a lot of headaches to many people. The other thing is the bandwidth that we use for downlink the data. We are using the S band, that is a very old band that is very reliable, but it allows only very little data to be downlinked. So we would have gone for sure for an X band and downlinked much more data. I don't know, if we keep increasing the budget, I can tell you we will have added observations in the infrared that was on the table at the very beginning, but then it was too expensive to do that. Probably, I don't know, have another CCD. I don't know, but the most important things that for me, let's say maybe would have been possible with a little bit more budget, would be trying not to have the stars rotating around the field. And this is for thermal reasons. So maybe with more time to study and more money, we could have done that, and to invest in more data downlink. Yes.
Okay, thank you. So we're going to pass to the next question from Damien. So you should be able to talk. Yeah, you should be able to talk.
Hello. Thanks for the presentation first. I had a question about the mission. So the mission seems to be working quite well for now. Did any unpredicted problem happen to the mission that has been corrected from the start?
There are always problems. Yes, there were unpredicted things. But luckily, everything could be solved. You do a lot of tests, but then there are things that until you don't fly, you cannot think about them. For example, something very funny that we didn't understand for a while. When you are pointing to a star, because CHEOPS is in a low Earth orbit, it can happen that the Earth becomes, let's say, in between the telescope and the star. So basically, you are blinded by the Earth for a certain part of the orbit. That's known, that was perfectly okay. But during that time, you can also, depending on the pointing, see through the atmosphere. And there was a refraction effect where we saw that before or after an Earth occultation, the star was jumping And we didn't, I mean, at the beginning we said, what's this? I mean, what is, why is the star like arriving to the image or leaving the image? Until somebody said, but this is the atmosphere. It's a refraction effect that we see it moving because it is the atmosphere that is playing that trick. And yeah, there is nothing to do about that. It just affects one or two images, it's nothing. But sometimes this could lead to a loss of the star in the pointing, and that could be fixed and there was no problem. But yeah, it's one thing that was, it's a curiosity, let's say. I mentioned this because it's really a curiosity that none of us could think about. And you only see it when you're flying, because there is no way to model that. I mean, yes, of course, if you have to model the atmosphere, but for this kind of thing, you don't go to so many details when you model the observations that you're going to have. So that's an example of many, many. Fortunately, none of the issues we found was serious, and everything could be corrected.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, so we have a question from MT. So you're unmuted, you can talk now.
Yeah, thank you. The question is, are you going to test CHEOPS with one of the planetary system which has been found by the NASA Kepler satellite?
The Kepler field is not accessible for CHEOPS. It's in one of the regions or very close to the regions where we cannot point. The reason why we cannot point there is because if we were pointing in that direction, the sun will be hitting the radiators of CHEOPS, and for thermal reasons, that's something that is not technically allowed. So the Kepler field is not accessible. The K2 field, yes, because the Kepler second part was pointing to the ecliptic, and there we can observe anything. The thing is that Kepler was much bigger than CHEOPS, so it was almost a 1 meter telescope. So the precision that Kepler had cannot be beaten by CHEOPS. So it's all sort of doesn't make sense to observe these stars. We are very complementary to the TESS mission actually, because TESS is doing a survey of, it's an American mission, it's a, let's say, successor in a way of Kepler. And it has 10 centimeter telescopes, so it's observing bright stars in the whole globe. But then the precision that they can achieve with one or two observations is not the precision that you can achieve with CHEOPS. They are, let's say, worse. So what is the plan, and there is a very close collaboration with this, is that we will reobserve to get the best radius possible out of the targets that they discover. So let's say they do the first screening and then we do the most precise measurements on those targets.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, thank you very much. So do we have other questions? If you want to ask, you can still use the raise hand button that should be accessible for all of you. And if you don't have questions for now, but have questions for later, you can still contact us on social media and we'll answer these questions for you. So don't hesitate, but it's still better to ask them now while we're live. So don't hesitate. I think it should be all good right now. So we're going to end this conference now. So I'd like everybody to applaud Andrea Fortier for her participation. So I'm unmuting you all so you can applaud.
Yay!
Thank you.
Okay, so
thanks.
People can leave now, so I'm gonna leave the chat open for a while.
Conference.
Hello, Andrea.
Thank you, Andrea.
Merci.
Merci.
Ah, c'est toi qui dois la voir.
Gracias, André.
À toutes, souffre, montre comment tu fais.
J'essaie de sauter.
Non, mais ça va pas marcher si tu fais pas. Surjoue, hein. Vas-y, gêne pas.
Bonjour,
Jean. Au revoir.
Viens dans votre bagnole. Merci.
Je sais pas si elle nous voit.
Si, si, on vous voit. On vous voit.
Andrea?
You see us? Virginie speaking.
Après la première ligne.